And you can hold on to that till a little bit later, and we'll collect those when we take our offering. You can just throw it in the offering plate. And I heard one preacher say, as they were handing out the guest card, he said, just put your name, your address, your social security number, your credit card information, amen. I know sometimes it seems like in the day and age in which we live, identities are getting stolen. That's definitely not what we want to do here. We just want to thank you for coming today. Now, with that in mind, once again, we do want to go out and celebrate Christmas this week as a church family by caroling to folks who are in need some encouragement. And so at the end of the service this morning, we're going to have some slips available. If you know someone who could really use some encouragement this holiday season, maybe they lost their spouse, maybe they lost a family member or a friend, then let me encourage you to pick up one of those slips, and I'll tell you where to get those, and you can nominate that individual, and then we'll try to go by and sing to them on a Wednesday evening. If you are going to go with us, we're going to meet here at 6 o'clock. We'll have coffee and hot chocolate and some refreshments, and then we're going to leave at 6:30. And Lord willing, we'll be able to all go together as a church family. If there's a lot of visits that need to be made, then we'll divide up into a couple groups. But please, once again, go out with us and try to make someone's Christmas a little bit merrier this year by just going and singing some Christmas songs in front of their house. You'd be surprised how people enjoy that and how that they'll be surprised that so many folks cared enough to actually come out and sing to them. And so let me challenge you to do that. Also, church family, while I have you here, I want to make sure that I remind you to come Thursday, December 31st, to our vision service at 6 o'clock. We'll be talking about the goals for 2016, reviewing the phrases from 2015, and then we're going to have our banner hanging up here with our theme for the upcoming year, as well as magnets to give out for all the church family to put on your refrigerator to keep that theme in front of you this upcoming year. And then also we'll have a tool to give out to you, a gift from our church to every family in our church, something that you can use each and every day of this next year. And it'll help you personally, and it'll help your family spiritually. And so let me encourage you to be here for that service as well. Let's dedicate our songs. We'll sing one more song here this morning. And then we're going to get ready to have the young people come and perform for us. Go ahead and take those songbooks, and we'll turn back here to our Christmas section. And let's sing, O Come All Ye Faithful. Let me find the page number for you real quickly. O Come All Ye Faithful, page number 424. Page 424, O Come All Ye Faithful. On the second and third verse, notice there's a rest at the beginning. So we'll pause and then start into those verses. Page 424.
Come and behold.
thank our young people to come out here, and they have been working hard the last several weeks. I'm going to get to this microphone ready, so while I do, young people, let's go ahead and take a deep breath. Ready? Get those nerves out. All right, you guys have been working hard, and we're excited to see what you've been working to perform for us this morning. And no matter what, we're going to be proud of you, right, adults?
Amen.
No matter what, we're going to be proud of you just for getting up here and doing your best. And many of us adults understand that we have scary faces. So don't look at the scary face people, all right? Now look at the other people.
Oh, man.
In other words, don't be looking back at Brother G in the back. I'm just kidding. I'm going to go ahead and set this up. I'll get out of their way, and then we'll let the young people perform their skill.
Who's hiding behind you?
A long time ago, in the town of Bethlehem, a Savior was born, which was Christ the Lord.
Wait a minute, what are you doing?
What do you mean, what am I doing? We're doing the Christmas play. You know that. What's the matter with you? Look around. Everyone's here. Even our parents are here. Hi, Daddy!
Well, see, I've been thinking about it, and I don't know if I believe all or not.
What? Don't believe it? Are you kidding me? What don't you believe?
I don't know if I believe in a Christmas story.
Oh, my head hurts. I feel so faint. Wait! I've had an epitome.
You mean no epiphany?
Whatever. I'll tell you the Christmas story, and you can decide whether you believe it or not. But whether you believe it or not, it is still true. And that's a really good thing, is that since it's true, no one can ever take it from you.
Alright, if you think it would help, thanks.
Let's do it! A while back, we met a woman named Mary.
Hi, Mary!
Hi! Do you believe yet?
I don't know. Is she supposed to be talking to me?
Mary lived in a town called Nazareth. The town is still there. You can go see it.
Oh, thanks.
Mary promised to be married to a man named Joseph.
She looks really nice. I bet we can be friends.
Quiet! One day, Mary was visited by an angel of God.
Now see, right there, an angel here on earth talking to some girl named Mary. I mean, there's no archaeological proof of that.
Did you get breakfast this morning?
Yes.
Do you have any archaeological proof of that?
Nope.
My point exactly. So this angel says to Mary,
Hail, Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee.
Doesn't that sound like a strange greeting to you?
I imagine that's what Mary thinks. She looks really scared.
Don't be afraid, Mary. You are found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High.
How would this be since I'm a virgin?
I know all about that story.
Shh! The angels need to tell her.
The Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you, so the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God.
That's not what my parents told me.
I told you. Shh! The angel's still speaking.
Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a baby in her old age, for nothing is impossible with God.
That's amazing! Oh, sorry, my bad. Who's this Elizabeth chick? Did you skip a page?
Wait, Mary has more line.
I'm the Lord's servant. Give me to me as you have said.
Then the angel left her. Then the angel left her.
Sorry.
And then Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea to see her relative, Elizabeth.
Hey, where's Mary going? Who's this Elizabeth chick?
Elizabeth was Mary's older cousin who lived in another town. She'd been married to a good man named Zechariah for many, 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 many years.
Strange. She doesn't look that old.
This is an actress. Months earlier, the angel had visited Elizabeth's husband, Zechariah.
Dude, I nearly skipped the page.
The angel had visited Elizabeth's husband, Zechariah, and he had come to offer the sacrifice at the temple.
What's the temple?
My church, but before Jesus.
Oh.
The angel said,
Hey, is that the same angel?
Yes, it is. See, it was the same angel. We like to try and stay as close to reality as we can here.
Oh yeah, I can see your angel here looks a lot like the real thing.
The angel says to Zechariah.
Don't be afraid, Zechariah.
Your angel there seems to say that a lot.
Actually, angels are quite imposing figures. You can look it up in a various passage in the Bible where angelic appearances are recorded. Almost all of them reflect how frightened the person seeing them become.
Dude, I didn't understand a word you said.
Anyway, they ended up having to say almost every
What?
Don't be afraid.
Zechariah, your prayer has been heard. Wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to give him the name John. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord, and he will help make ready a people prepared for the Lord.
Wow, did you hear what he just said? He called his wife old. Dude, is he in trouble?
Oh, he did something worse than that. He questioned an angel. Watch this.
I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and tell you this good news. But now you will be silent and not be able to speak until the day this happens because you do not believe my words, which will come true at the proper time.
Hey, what happened to his voice?
John, laryngitis, power of God. Wow, you said it. Sure enough, just like the angel had said, Zechariah and Elizabeth were soon expecting their first baby, despite their old age. But Zechariah still couldn't speak. It wasn't very long at all before Mary came to visit her cousin Elizabeth.
Elizabeth! Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child who will bear. As soon as your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leapt for joy. Blessed is she that believeth that what the Lord has accomplished. My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations shall call me blessed, for the mighty one has done great things for me. Holy is his name.
Mary visited with Elizabeth and Zechariah lasted about 3 months, and then Mary went back home to Nazareth.
Bye, Mary!
Bye! You think yet?
I don't know.
When Elizabeth's time came, she was delivered of a baby boy, just as the angel had told Zechariah. When it was time to name the baby, their friends and neighbors asked him,
"What is the baby's name?"
"His name is to be John."
"John, but none of his relatives were named John. He has a name after somebody in his family. Zechariah, what do you think about this? What's his name to be?"
"His name is to be John."
John.
Suddenly, Zechariah can speak again.
So you think your Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come and redeemed his people. You would go when the Lord to prepare the way for him to tell the people the knowledge of salvation. Because of the forgiveness of their sins, because of the grateful mercy of our God."
Wow, all that time of silence must have given him time to think about what he would say.
And John grew up and became a great man of God, just like the angel had said. And later, he would be known as John the Baptist.
He was a Baptist?
Let's not get into that right now. Do you believe yet?
I don't know.
Let's listen to some music, and then we'll have part two.
Will Mary be back?
Oh, I'm sure she will. She has a pretty big heart, too.
All right, then.
Thank you.
Nazareth, we find Joseph, the man pledged to marry Mary, asleep in his bed. Joseph has had a hard day because as soon as Mary got back from visiting with Elizabeth, it was obvious to everyone that she was going to have a baby.
Joseph looks way too young for Mary.
I told you these are actors. Now, Joseph was a very good man, and so he wanted to be kind and generous towards Mary. But since he knew the baby wasn't his, he wasn't sure what to do next. While he was still considering his options, the angel of the Lord came to him in a dream.
Oh no, not this guy again. Didn't you have anyone else who wanted to play an angel?
Remember Zechariah.
Moving on.
Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife. For what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins.
When Joseph pulled up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him, and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not touch her until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus.
Hey, Mary!
Hi, do you believe yet?
I don't know.
Here, you reel off.
Why?
Because my mouth is tired and I've been talking all morning.
Well, that's for sure. Where'd you leave off? Oh, here it is. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that everyone in the Roman world would be counted. What on earth would somebody order something stupid like that?
Tax base.
Oh, now So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. Hey, is this almost over? Because I'm getting hungry. Are there going to be cookies?
Yes, there are going to be cookies. Of course there are going to be cookies. There are always cookies. Now read.
While they were there, time came for the born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in swaddling clothes and placed him in a manger, because there was no room for him in the inn. Wow, Mary!
Do you believe yet?
I don't know, but that's a very pretty baby you got there.
Yes, he's the son of God.
And that's the end of part two.
Time for cookies?
Nope, time for songs.
Praising God and and saying,
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men.
When the angels had left and they gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another,
Let's go see this thing that has happened which the Lord has told us about.
So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph, and the baby who was lying in a manger.
The shepherds returned glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. Well, that's that. What a nice Christmas story.
Hey, hold it. What happens next?
Oh, you don't want to know.
Yes, I do. What happens to Mary? What happens to the baby? How am I supposed to believe in the Christmas story if I don't know what happens?
Are you sure you want to know?
Yes.
Be careful. Wanting to know is the first step to believing.
All right. I want to know. Tell me.
Well, okay. We'll read it together. You start.
Not too far away, the King Herod. He was the king of the whole area where Mary and Joseph were living. Hey, why don't I like him?
Because you have good taste.
Who are those guys?
They are some wise men who live in the country nearby. They have come to find baby Jesus.
I saw a star in the east, so I come to worship.
King Herod knew the ancient prophecies that there would be a Messiah born to the Jews. He knew that this was the king they were talking about. He secretly didn't want any king but himself. He called all the Jewish leaders together and asked them, where are they? So the wise men told King Herod exactly when they had seen the star appear.
Go and find him, and when you find him, come back and tell the king, so that he can come and worship him as well.
Wait a minute, I don't like this. Herod needs to hurt them.
It'll be okay.
No, no, we gotta do something. We gotta warn them.
There is nothing to do. Do you want to go on and hear the rest of the story?
I don't know. Yes?
Okay, then let's read. The wise men went on their way, and the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed.
On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and of frankincense and of myrrh.
And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route.
Another route? You mean they didn't go back to Herod? Mary's fate?
Yes.
Well, not quite.
What?
Well, hurry up. Keep reading. Here, let me do it. When they had gone, the angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. Oh, no. You're kidding me. Not again.
Take the child and his mother and escape to Egypt and stay there until I tell you. For King Herod is going to search for the child to kill him.
So Joseph got up and took the child and his mother during the night and left for Egypt where they stayed until the death of Herod.
Yes, they made it. The baby's safe. Score! That is the greatest story ever. That is the coolest angel I've ever seen. Angel, nice. Good work. So is that the end?
Well, almost. Later, Joseph was visited by an angel in a dream and told that Herod had died. So he and Mary and the young child Jesus moved back from Egypt to their hometown of Nazareth. And there is a very happy ending. Jesus grew up, lived a sinless life, taught about God, who was his father, and later paid the price for the sins of the world. And now all those who believe in him will have eternal life. So now the question is the same one Mary has been asking you all morning.
Do you believe yet?
Do I believe yet? Yes, you know, I think I do. I really do.
See, it really is a Christmas to believe in.
That was awesome. Time for cookies?
Right after the last couple songs.
I do believe, you know, I think it was the angel. He was great.
Amen.
content.
Support our missionaries around the world, you can put that offering in the plate as it's passed around. So I'm going to have our ushers come. I'll pray for the offering, and then we're going to sing the first Noel as they're receiving the offering, receiving those guest cards this morning. Let's go, Lord, in prayer, and then we'll sing. Father, thank you for your goodness to us. Thank you once again for these young people and for the workers helping them. Father, what a wonderful job they did this morning. And Father, we pray that you would continue to use these young ones. Father, as we know in the Word of God, that even a little child can be used in a great mighty way by you. Father, we pray that you would just lead, guide, and direct the rest of this service and use it for your honor, glory, and praise. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Page 421, it's in the first Noel. As they come around and receive the offering, they receive those cards this morning. Thank you. you this morning. Before I share something with you from the Word of God, once again, thank you, young people, for your performance and your hard work. And we are going to celebrate that tonight in our Christmas party, so make sure you're back here tonight for that. Also, we heard one of the narrators mention cookies. So a few of the ladies in the church made some cookies this morning, and we'll have those available as you head out the door after the service here. On that table there will be the cookies and also those slips that I mentioned for Christmas caroling. If you want to nominate someone for Christmas caroling, pick one of those up, and then make sure you either bring it back tonight if you're planning on attending the party tonight, or give it to me before you leave if you're not going to be back. We want to make sure that we do something special for those that really need some encouragement this Christmas season. And then also, if it came to my attention, I did forget one person. We forgot to thank Miss Liz for helping out as well. She sang the special for us. So let's go ahead and give Miss Liz a round of applause. Are with us, and our boys have been able to participate as well, and so appreciate you doing that. I never want to overlook anybody. If there's anybody else, oh, and Mrs. Davis for doing our scenery, sorry, and thank you, our rangers. And someone else, Ms. Garland. Of the teenagers, yes. Let's see here, Monet, Jasmine, Abigail, Jasmine, and Cassandra. Did I miss anybody else? That's it. All right, so for all the people that Preacher for God, all right, let's pray. Thank you guys so much for being here. I do want to share something with you. You know, so often we think about Christmas and we think about the gifts, all right? I know you kids are probably excited about the gifts. This is the time of year where it seems like everybody goes out of their way concerning gifts. We even overdo it. I was reading a story about a man by the name of Tom. He had gone out on a business trip, and he came back, and it was getting close to Christmas time, and he thought, well, I better get something nice to take back to my wife to show her that I missed her and how much I appreciate her. And, of course, that's why we give gifts. And so he went to the department store, and he walks up to the perfume counter, and he said, ma'am, I need to see something inexpensive, but something that I could give my wife. And so she pulls out a bottle of perfume, and she sprays a little bit for him, and says, oh, that smells nice. He said, how much is that? She says, $50. He goes, it's a little bit too expensive. Can I get some a little bit less expensive or a little bit cheaper? And she pulls out another bottle and she sprays it and he smells it and goes, oh, that's nice too. How much is that? She says, oh, about $30. Still a little bit too much. She pulls out one final bottle and she says, this is the lowest I can go. And she sprays it and he smells it and goes, that's good too. How much is that? And she goes, $15. He goes, man, you don't understand. I need something that is inexpensive. Can you show me something that might be cheap? And she turns around, she grabs a mirror and holds it up for him. Now, we try to go out of our way, spend more at Christmas because we focus on the gifts. And as much as gifts are great to give and they're great to receive, we know that it's not about how much we spend. We know it's not about the gifts per se, but it's about the greatest gift, the gift of eternal life. And that comes through Jesus Christ, or came to us through Jesus Christ. Back in Luke chapter number 2, I just want to share something real quick with you. In verses 1 through 7, of course, we have the story that is known as the Nativity story or the Christmas story. And I want to read that for you, but then I want to read verse number 8. And I want to share a thought with you from verse number 8 this morning. Luke chapter 2, verse number 1. If you have your Bible and you want to follow along, you're more than welcome to. It says here, and it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, everyone into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth into Judea under the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Now verse number 8 reads like this. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And I want to talk to you about the seeking shepherds this morning. Let's pray one more time, and then I'll just share a quick thought with you. Father, once again, we thank you for all that's been said and done this morning, for everything that we've heard. And now we pray that you bless the next few minutes in the most important part of this service, which is the teaching and preaching of your word. Now, Father, I pray that our hearts would be open. I pray that our ears would be attentive. And may you speak. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Amen. Now, verse number 8 once again says, and we're in the same country, shepherds abiding in the field. And I want to talk to you about the shepherds this morning. You know, a survey was done recently where they went around and they asked people, the characters in the Christmas story, which character do you relate to the best? And, of course, we know the characters in the Christmas story. They were mentioned this morning. And the people would think about it. And they would think about the angel. They'd think about Joseph and Mary. They would think about, of course, the wise men who came later on when Jesus was a little child. And they thought about all of these individuals. And they said, you know, I relate to the shepherds. More people said, I relate to the shepherds than to any other character in the Christmas story or in the Nativity story. And when we think about it, we can understand why. I mean, when we think of the angels, even someone who thinks that they're good and thinks that they're righteous, in comparison to an angel that comes from the presence of God, and when he would come to earth, he would have a glow about him because he had just come from the presence of God. Anyone who thinks of himself as good or as righteous, still, in comparison to an angel, would say, I can't really relate to an angel that much. Joseph and Mary, though they were human, just like you and I, though they had trials and tribulations and temptations the way that you and I do, we look at Joseph and we say, well, the Bible tells us he was a just man. He had a good testimony, and Mary was called blessed among women. And so most people look at Joseph and Mary and they say, well, I'm not sure if I'm at that spiritual level yet. I don't know if I've reached that point in my life to be a Joseph or a Mary. And so most people would say, I can't relate to them. Really, we look at the wise men then who came later and we say, well, you know, gold, myrrh, frankincense, those are lavish gifts that they bestowed upon the Christ. And honestly, a lot of us can't relate just because of their stature or because of their position and how that they were known as wise men who were also men of authority and men with wealth. But when we look at the story and we think of the shepherds, and then there's one other person that's left in the story, the Christ. Now, I don't believe there's one person on the face of the earth that would say, oh yeah, I'm in the same league as the Christ. I remember back when my wife and I were in Bible college, and we would go to a nursing home. We went to separate nursing homes every week, and we ministered to the folks there. And one week, one of the men, our young men that went to her nursing home, or the one she ministered in, wasn't able to go. He asked me to go on his behalf, and so I went, and the other young man that was with me that helped with the service, his name was Thomas Johnston. And so Thomas and I, we did the service. He led the singing and sort of conducted the service, and then I preached. My wife was there, and two other young ladies were there. And afterwards, we went around, and we shook hands with all the people, and we thanked them for coming. And there was a lady there by the name of Miss Leah. And I'll never forget Miss Leah for a number of reasons, but I'll tell you the most important reason why here in a minute. We went by and shook hands, and I talked to Miss Leah, and she said, oh, you're engaged, or you're dating this young lady over here, Miss Stephanie? I said, yes, ma'am. And she goes, oh, she goes, well, Thomas, he is the master of ceremonies, Brother Miller. She goes, but you're the greatest thing to happen to us since Jesus was born. And I said, Steph, come over here. I want you to talk to this lady for a minute. I forgot Miss Lena because she made such a ridiculous comparison. Not one of us would say that we can relate to the Christ. Not one of us can say, oh yeah, I've never sinned, that I'm sinless. I understand what the Son of God went through when he left heaven to come to this earth. But we look at the shepherds, and we can relate to them. And you know, we don't pick the shepherds, and most people in that survey did pick the shepherds as the character they could relate to by default, because that was the only character left in the story. But I think there's more reason behind it. I believe a lot of it is subconscious, actually. I'm going to point three things out to you real quickly here this morning as to why most people, maybe even why us this morning, why we can relate to these shepherds. First off, all three of these points begin with L. First off, because of their living or their livelihood. In verse number 8, it says, and there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. Here it is, one verse. We're told that they were there in the fields. It said they abided in the fields. All right, so they lived there in those fields. And they had a job. They had an occupation. Their occupation was to keep watch over their flocks, to watch over these sheep. I believe most people can relate to the shepherds because the shepherds weren't much different than us in the 21st century. Here they had a place to live. It was a humble place. It was the fields. And they had a job or an occupation to carry out, employment. But it wasn't the greatest job in the world. They weren't a CEO of a company. But they were just a casual worker. They were the average worker out there watching over the sheep. And most people today are much like the shepherds. Oh, maybe they're not in that top 1% of millionaires, but then they don't find themselves also in poverty levels. They find themselves as a middle-class citizen. And they have a home and they have a car. It may not be the nicest home, may not be the nicest car. They may not have a ton of money in the bank, but they have a modest living. They have a place to lay their head at night. You know, when we think about these shepherds, though they may not have been rich in their society, if they would have been compared to people of other parts of the world at that time, maybe those that had grown up in the jungles of Africa, even in their time, they would have been richer than those. Comparing them maybe to those that were slaves in their time, they would have been richer than those individuals because at least they would have had their freedom. And so we can always look at our situation and say, well, I'm really sort of poor. I don't have a lot. But when we compare ourselves to the people around the world this morning, when we compare ourselves to the people in the countries known as third world countries, we feel pretty rich. We feel pretty fortunate. And these shepherds were the same way. They were right in the middle there. They weren't really the poorest of people, but they definitely weren't the richest of people. And so 21st century people can relate to the shepherds. They also had, as I said, a job, an occupation. And their job was to watch over their sheep. You know, as I was growing up, I remember people, teachers all the time saying, and parents saying, remember, there's always someone watching you. You know, everyone in this room has a little sheep or some little sheep that are watching them. Whether it be your children or your grandchildren, whether it be the people that you work with who don't know Christ as Savior, all of us have someone who's looking up to us. Even the youngest child in this room has a smaller brother or sister or friend who looks up to them. And ultimately, those are the ones that God has given us the charge over, to try to help them and to try to bring them to know Christ as Savior. And so we see, first off, their living or their livelihood. But then we see, second, their longing. In the 21st century, I believe a lot of people are longing. Oh, they have a modest living. They have a decent home, and they have a decent job, but something's missing this morning. In the story, in verse number 9, as we heard the young people tell us earlier, it says, "And a lowly angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them. And they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you, ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." Now, up to this point, we don't really see the longing of the shepherds. But in the very next verse, you'll notice it here. In verse number 15, it says, "And it came to pass as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, Let us now go even unto Bethlehem, and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us." They were outside of Bethlehem. They were outside of the city of David. They weren't in Bethlehem. And they get this message that the Savior, the Christ, has been born, and they can find him in Bethlehem. And so immediately after the angels, the messengers, ascend or disappear, they go ahead and turn to each other and they have a conversation. What should we do? Should we stay here? Should we go into town? And you know what? They were 100% for going into town, showing that even though they had a modest living, there was still something missing. And even they were wise enough to know that there was something missing. And they knew what it was after those angels came and told them. It was salvation. They were missing the peace of God in their hearts and in their lives. And so they said, let's go. Let's and see this thing that's come to pass, which the Lord has made known unto us. And it tells us that they made haste in the very next verse, which means that they went quickly. They had a longing. They wanted to find what they were missing. This morning, there are so many people in the world today who they've got a modest living, but they're longing for something. They look at their life and they say, you know, there's nothing wrong with what I have. There's nothing wrong with the possessions I have. I love the children that I have. I enjoy the work that I do. But there's something missing, and I can't put a finger on what it is. This morning, let me tell you that God is giving you a message. I would not say that I'm an angel per se, but an angel was a messenger. So as a messenger this morning, I'm here to tell you that what you're missing, what you're longing for, is exactly what God created you to long for, which is His Son, Jesus Christ. Salvation. The light that the Bible tells us in John chapter number 1, which lighteth every man. This morning, if you're wondering why is it that there's still this one thing that seems like it's missing in my life. I mean, everything seems to be perfect in my life, but there's one thing that's missing. It's Jesus Christ.
Amen.
It's salvation. It's the peace of God. And so these shepherds were longing. And then third, we see, as I just referenced a moment ago, that they went looking. In verse number 15, once again, listen to the words of the shepherds. They said, "Let us now go even into Bethlehem." They wanted to do it immediately. They began their search. Now think about this, if you would. Because we often read this passage and we read these verses and we think, yeah, the shepherds, they were there, the angels spoke to them. They went into Bethlehem and they find the baby, they find Jesus. Oh, it's just such a simple thing and it's covered in just a minimal amount of verses. But think about what transpired. They're going into the city of Bethlehem. Though it was not a great metropolis at the time, they're still going into a town or a city, and they have to search out through the city to find this one child out of all those that were there. Now remember who was there at that time. All those that were of the house and lineage of David. So the normal population of Bethlehem was not there, but a greater population, more than likely, being the descendants of David, King David himself. And so they had to go into the town, and normally when you go around your town, you know your town. Many of us who are from Atwater, we know Atwater. Many of us have grown up here and lived here for years, so we know it like the back of our hand. Hey, these shepherds were going into town and meeting a lot of strangers. Could you imagine being the shepherds, having to knock on someone's door, sorry about you, just trying to find out, did you guys have a baby here tonight? No, thank you. Shut the door on him. I mean, shepherds, once again, weren't the most attractive individuals to look at. They definitely didn't have the best aroma about them either, working around sheep. But nonetheless, they set out on this journey to look, to search. This morning, I believe every person in the 21st century is looking. But the problem is, they're looking in the wrong places, or they're finding the wrong things to ultimately appease that longing that they have. They're looking to organize religion. And they're saying, well, if I could just be religious, then that would fill that void inside me. And the Bible teaches that religion doesn't fill that void. Only Jesus fills that void. Some people are looking to the money, and they're looking to the possessions, and they're saying, if I can just get more, if I can just move up in society, I'll be so much happier that longing will go away, I'll feel whole. No, you won't. Because the Bible says that riches have wings and they flee away or fly away from us. Hey, you won't be content. You won't be happy. That longing won't be gone. Because the one thing you still need is Jesus Christ as your Savior. These shepherds, they went and they searched Him out right away. As we said in verse number 16, it says, and they came with haste. And notice in verse 16 it says, and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. They found what they needed. They found what they set out to search for. This morning, I don't know your life, but I know, according to the Bible, that if you don't have Christ as your Savior, you're missing something. You're missing the most important part of your life. And this morning you came to hear these young people and to encourage them and to support them. But at the same time, There's a longing inside you if you don't know Christ as Savior. And God wants you to know you can have that longing filled by receiving His Son as your Savior. Probably my favorite illustration, I tell this at so many services, and every time I have an opportunity to do a funeral service, I'll use this illustration because it's so effective. It's a story of a rich man. And this rich man had one son. His wife had passed on. The rich man's wife had passed on. And so he had one son, and he and his son were very close. And they loved to do everything together. The rich man was fond of art and collecting art. So he would travel around the world, and he'd buy paintings and sculptures and various artworks, and he'd bring them back to their mansion and place them there in their mansion. And his son would go with him. And they both grew fond of collecting art together. And so they built a close kinship, a close relationship as a father and son. Well, one day their country was at war, and so one day a telegram came to the rich man's house, and they were told that his son had been drafted into the army. And so his son willingly went off and fought for their country, but unfortunately he passed away. He died in battle. A telegram was sent to the rich man much later, telling him of his son's death and how that his son had actually given his life in exchange for somebody else in order that someone else might live. And so, of course, though he missed his son, that fondness, that love for his son grew with that receiving of that telegram. Well, later on, this rich man passed away, and people from all over the world came, art collectors, because they wanted to bid on these priceless pieces of art that he had gathered. And so they gathered in that large room in the mansion, and the auctioneer got up and he took the gavel and he hit it on the lectern and he says, "All right, we've got to start the auction now. And so to start the auction off, we're going to start with this painting right over here." And he pointed to a painting that had been given to the rich man years earlier by a neighbor. It was a drawing of the rich man's son. And though the neighbor was not a fantastic artist or a great painter, he did his best drawing of the rich man's son after his son had passed away, knowing that that might comfort the rich man. So the auctioneer points to the painting and he says, "Here we have a painting of this man's son, and we need to auction this off before anything else." All the people that were gathered there, they said, "Oh, we don't want that. We didn't come all the way around the world to buy that. We came for the sculptures and the paintings that are priceless. That's what we want to bid on." The auctioneer was stern. He says, No, I'm sorry. We have to sell this painting." "No, I have a bid." "Well, anybody bid on it?" And no one raised their hand. He says, "Please, is there one that will bid on this painting this morning?" And finally, a hand went up in the back. And a bid was made. It was the next door neighbor who had painted the painting years earlier. And he says, "All right, sir, I see your hand. Now, I hear your bid. Is there anyone that wants to bid higher?" No one bid higher. So he goes, "All right, going once, going twice." Sold to the man in the back. And with that, everybody applauded. "All right, on to the good stuff, finally." He says, "No, I'm sorry." He takes the gavel and he hits it on the lectern again. And he says, "With that sell, the auction is closed." Oh, these people were furious. They said, "What are you talking about? We've flown from all over the world to bid on these pieces of art. What do you mean the auction's over?" He says, "You see, I have the will of the man who passed away, the rich man. I have his will in front of me. And according to the will of the Father, he who takes the Son gets it all." And this morning, that's exactly the way it works with God. He who takes the Son gets it all. You get the peace of God that He offers. You get the love of God that He offers. You get that joy that is joy unspeakable, as the Bible talks about. You get that missing peace to your life this morning. As we close in verse number 20, I want you to see something. It says in verse 20, "And the shepherds returned glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen as it was told unto them." The Bible tells us that these shepherds, they went back to the field. They went back to their modest living. They went back to their modest occupation. But they went back differently. They went back praising God. They went back glorifying God. Oh, they were still shepherds. Finding the Christ didn't change that. By the way, this morning, let me just warn you. If someone preaches to you that receiving Christ as your Savior means that you're going to get a better job, you're going to get more money, they're preaching a false gospel this morning. Because God never promises that. He never says your occupation is going to change. He never says that your home is going to be better, or your house is going to be nicer, or your car is going to be better. He never promises that, but he promises that you will be different. And this morning, I believe that many people, when they took that survey, they said, oh, yeah, the shepherds, I can relate to the shepherds. And subconsciously, they said that, not even realizing how much they're like the shepherds. With a modest living that caused them to have a longing that ultimately resulted in them looking and finding exactly what they needed, Jesus Christ. Once again, maybe you don't know the Lord as your Savior this morning, then God wants you to receive Him today. And if you are, let me challenge you, go back in your mind this morning to that time when you received Christ as your Savior. Don't ever forget that time, because He changed your life that day. You ought to be different this morning. Let's pray. Father, thank you for all that you've done for us. Thank you for all that you've given to us. Lord, you have been so gracious.